ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي واجعل لي وزيرا من أهلي. ربي يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين يا فتاح. ربي زدني علما. اللهم فقهنا في الدين. اللهم فقهنا في الدين. اللهم فقهنا في الدين. اللهم إني أسألك رضاك والجنة. اللهم إني أسألك رضاك والجنة. اللهم إني أسألك رضاك والجنة. اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا. اللهم إني أسألك العافية. Ameen ya rahmar rahimeen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Once again, alhamdulillah, we are covering the Quran from the beginning, that is Surah Fatiha, and we are talking about, we cover a few ayahs every week, and then we talk about the meaning of, a brief meaning of that ayah, and then some lessons that we can derive from it. And today we are going to cover Surah Baqarah, ayah number 230 till 233, four ayat, inshallah. So first, let's go over the word by word meaning. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا تَحِلُّ لَهُ مِن بَعْدُ حَتَّى تَنْكِحَ زَوْجًا غَيْرَهُ فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَن يَتَرَاجَعَا إِن ظَنَّا أن يقيما حدود الله وتلك حدود الله يبينها لقوم يعلمون.
So previously, last week, we talked about the ayat. We began with the topic of divorce, and we started talking about it. And this week and one more week, inshallah, we'll be covering more details about that topic. So let's begin with this. For in, then if, two words. For is then, in, if, طلقها. طلقها, طلاق, and ha refers to her. It's a pronoun, so طلقها. He divorces her. So if, then if he divorces her, and this refers to the third talaq. So we, in the previous ayat, we covered that that the talaq which can be revoked is twice. So this talaqaha is referring to the third one, final talaq, irrevocable. The one that cannot be revoked now, and the person cannot remarry. Fala tahillu, then not. Tahillu, she is not halal anymore, she is not lawful, lahu, for him, mim ba'du, from after that, hatta, until, tankiha, she marries, zawjan ghayrahu, zawjan, a spouse. Zawj is a word that is used for a spouse, or zawj, usually used for both, for a husband, it would be for a wife, and for a wife, it would be for a husband. So zawj is a spouse, or a married partner, right? So until she marries a spouse, غيره, which is other than him, غير, somebody other than who, him. So غيره, other than him. Okay, this, after the final talaq is given, then he cannot marry her until she marries somebody else. فَإِن طَلَّقَهَا, then if he divorces her. Now this he is going back to the second person. This the second person that she married after the third talaq is done, if she married somebody else, and then for some reason something happens, and then this second person also divorces her. فَلَا جُنَاحَ, then in that situation, that very unique and very once in a while kind of a situation, then there is no junaha, gunah, or sin upon alayhima, upon both of them. Both of them meaning that now that she is divorced from the second person, there's no sin on the wife and the first husband. And that yataraja, that they raja'a, to return, right? We say inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Raja'a, to return to some, but that we say that ya Allah, we belong to you and we'll return to you, right? So raja'a, to return, and that there is no sin upon both of them then if they return to each other. in dhanna, if dhanna, they believe, and that yuqima, that they can uphold, they can keep. Qayyim, is to make, to keep something upright, to hold something. So if they are able to keep what? Hududallahi. Hududallahi is a mudaf mudafili. Hududa, and for the grammar part of it, hudud is a plural, which means the limits, like the boundaries set by, and hudud of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So hududallahi, the limits set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Watilka, and these hududullahi are the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yubayyinuha, he makes them clear. Makes them clear, ha refers to them. And what is them referring to? The limits of Allah. That he makes these limits clear. لِقَوْمِي يَعْلَمُونَ, for a people who have ilm, who are, who know, or who are the seekers of knowledge. So he makes these things clear for them. So in this ayah, Allah Ta'ala is saying, and if he has divorced her for the third time, which is the final irrevocable time, then she's not lawful for him afterwards. Until in the way, if something happens and then she marries a husband other than him, and if the second husband also divorces her or he dies, then there is no blame upon the woman and the former husband to return to each other. If they think, and that there is a second condition, that if they think they can keep within the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are the limits of Allah, which he makes clear to people who know. And we'll talk a little bit more and later, inshallah. Then 231. بسم الله الرحمن
الرحيم. وإذا طلقتم النساء فبلغن أجلهن فأمسكوهن بمعروف أو سرحوهن بمعروف ولا تمسكوهن ضرارا لتعتدوا ومن يفعل ذلك فقد ظلم نفسه ولا تتخذوا آيات الله هزوا واذكروا نعمة الله عليكم وما أنزل عليكم من الكتاب والحكمة يعظكم به واتقوا الله واعلموا أن الله بكل شيء عليم.
وإذا and when طلقتم, that you divorce nisa'a, the women. So you hear tum refers to all of you. So Allah Ta'ala is addressing a group of Muslims. So if you divorce the women, فَبَلَغْنَا, بَلَغَ, to reach something. Like we say that child, when the child comes of age, we say that he has become baligh, he or she has become baligh, right? So to reach some place is called بَلَغَ. So, and when you divorce the women and they reach أَجَلَهُنَّ, أَجَلَ, the wait, the period, the time period, hunna, theirs. So when they reach their waiting period, as in they've completed their, they're completing their iddat, the time after the waiting period after the divorce, which we learned before was 3 months, or if a girl is pregnant, then until her delivery. فَأَمْسِكُوهُنَّ, then either retain them, بِمَعْرُوفٍ, in a fair manner, أَوْ سَرِّحُوهُنَّ, or release them, بِمَعْرُوفٍ, in a fair manner. So either keep them in a fair manner or release them in a fair manner. وَلَا تُمْسِكُوهُنَّ, and do not retain them, ضِرَارًا, to hurt, لِتَعْتَدُوا, so that you may transgress. Transgress what? The, as we continue from the previous ayah, transgress the boundaries of Allah. So the boundaries of Allah mean that some provisions have been given to you, but the purpose of these provisions is to make things good and better in a society, and understand the law and the spirit of law, and don't misuse the things that are given to them, right? So either retain them, but don't retain them with the purpose of hurting them. And if you do that, you'll be transgressing. وَمَنْ يَفْعَلْ, then whoever does ذَلِكَ, that, as in whoever retains the woman to hurt them, the intention is to hurt the woman, or to basically the to be narcissistic, or to like basically have to trouble the woman, or to torture her, or make it hard for her, make life hard for her, then whoever does that, فَقَدْ, then indeed ظَلَمَ نَفْسَهُ, then he has wronged, he hasn't wronged that poor woman, he's not wronged that woman who was helpless, he has wronged himself. وَلَا تَتَّخِذُوا and do not take آيَاتِ اللَّهِ the آيَات of Allah. And here the آيَات of Allah refers to the أَحْكَام of Allah. The signs of Allah here, they refers to the أَحْكَام, the laws and the limits that Allah Ta'ala has given. Huzuwa, huzuwa, something that you're making fun of something and you're taking it in like, my stride, you know, like something that you're not like bothered too much about. So don't take the ahkam of Allah, the signs of Allah in jest. Don't think they're minor or there is anything small. It's a very big deal. Wadhkuru, and remember, ni'matullahi, the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alaykum, upon you, wama, excuse me, wama, and what anzala is revealed alaykum to all of you, min al-kitabi, of the book, wal hikmati, and the wisdom. So book here refers to the Quran, and hikmah refers to the scholar. A lot of scholars say hikmah refers to the sunnah and the hadith of the Prophet ya'idukum, that he instructs you bihi, with it, that Allah, remember those favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he has sent down to you the book and the sunnah, and he instructs you with it. So that is a huge favor upon you. So don't take it and don't take those limits in jest, because that's a huge favor, and realize that it's a huge favor upon you. Wattaqullaha, and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa'alamu, and know what? Anna, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bikulli shay'in alim, that he is of everything all knowing, that whatever might be happening in the in public or private, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows every little thing that is happening. So basically in this ayah, we learn that Allah is telling us, and when you divorce women and they have nearly fulfilled their term, either retain them according to acceptable terms or release them according to acceptable terms. And do not keep them intending harm, to transgress against them. And whoever does that has certainly wronged himself. And do not take the verses of Allah in jest. And remember the favor of Allah upon you, and what has been revealed to you of the book and the wisdom by which he instructs you. And fear Allah Ta'ala, and know that Allah is knowing of all things. Then ayah
232. ينكحن أزواجهن إذا تراضوا بينهم بالمعروف ذلك يوعظ به من كان منكم يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر ذلكم أزكى لكم وأطهر والله يعلم وأنتم لا تعلمون.
وَإِذَا طَلَّقْتُمُ النِّسَاءَ, and when you divorce the women, فَبَلَغْنَ أَجَلَهُنَّ, and they reach their waiting term, so this is same as previous ayah, this part, فَلَا تَعْدُلُوهُنَّ, then do not hinder them, do not stop them, right? The word عَيْن, بَعْد, and لَمْ, عَدَلَ, that means to stop someone from something, to hinder somebody from doing something, to make it hard for them to do something, right? So in that meaning, so don't hinder them. An tankihna, that they marry, azwajahunna, their husbands, idha taradaw, when they agree. So if the divorce period has ended and their waiting time has ended and they want to marry somebody else, then and they agree to it, then don't stop them from it. Don't hinder this marriage. Don't be an obstacle in the marriage. If they agree, when they agree, bainahum, between themselves, bil ma'roof, in a fair manner, like they're trying to do something legitimate by marriage. She wants to marry somebody else, and that other person also wants to marry them. They don't want to just play around and things like that. Then you should not hinder this. And in fact, it should be, the marriage is a positive thing for the society, and it should be encouraged. Dalika, that you adu is admonished bihi, with it, man kana, whoever is minkum, among you, yu'minu billahi, whoever believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wal yawmil akhir, and the last day, dhalikum, that azka is more virtuous, is better, lakum, for you, wa athhar, and it is purer for you as well, wallahu ya'lamu, and Allah ta'ala knows, وأنتم لا تعلمون, and you do not know. So when you divorce women and they have fulfilled their term, then do not prevent them from remarrying. And there are two interpretations of this: either their former husbands, like as in if the a girl was married to somebody, they had she went through three talaq, and then after that she married somebody else, she could, because she's no more halal to this person now, and she marries a second husband, and the second husband also, either something happens and either there's a divorce that happens or that husband dies, now she is back to where she was. And now if she decides, and the first husband, and they decide to get remarried, then allow them marriage. Another interpretation is that if she's divorced the first husband and she wants to marry somebody else, then the first husband should not stop her from doing that, because she's not married to him anymore. He has no right to stop her, if they agree among themselves on an acceptable basis. This is instructed to whoever of you believes in Allah and the last day. So if you believe in Allah and the last day, then this is an instruction for you, and this is better for you and purer, and Allah knows and you do not know about this. Then the last ayah for today, ayah 233. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
والوالدات يرضعن أولادهن حولين كاملين لمن أراد أن يتم الرضاعة وعلى المولود له رزقهن وكسوتهن بالمعروف لا تكلف نفس إلا وسعها لا تضار والدة بولدها ولا مولود له بولده وعلى الوارث مثل ذلك فإن أرادا فصالا عن تراض منهما وتشاور فلا جناح عليهما وإن أردتم أن تسترضعوا أولادكم فلا جناح عليكم إذا سلمتم ما آتيتم بالمعروف واتقوا الله واعلموا أن الله بما تعملون بصير.
And the mothers, the walida, the mother, what they should do, they should suckle their children, as in this is talking about feeding their children, breastfeeding a child that is born. Auladahunna, their children, mother should suckle their children, they should breastfeed their children for haulaini kamilain, for complete 2 years. That is the recommended term. So for 2 years, and for some reasons, if they want to wean the child before 2 years, then it is allowed. But you should not keep feeding for a child after 2 years, right? And 2 years is the ideal term to complete 2 years. And 2 years here refer to the lunar year, not the solar year, right? So the lunar year is slightly shorter than the solar year. So in terms of the solar year, it will come to probably like 23 months instead of 24 months. Liman, so whoever arada wishes an yutimma rida'a, to complete the suckling, should do so. Obviously, that's implied. Wa alal mauludi, and upon the father of the child, lahu, on him, rizquhunna, is the provision, is her their provision, the provision of the mother. Wa kiswatuhunna, and their clothing, bil ma'aruf, in a fair manner. La tukallifu nafsun illa wusaha. It la tukallifu, is not burdened. Nafsun, any soul. So any soul is not burdened, illa wusaha, except its capacity. La tudarra, and is not made to suffer, walidatu, the mother. So the mother should not be made to suffer, bi waladiha, because of her child. Wala mauludun, and not the father, lahu bi waladihi, and neither should the father be made to suffer because of the child. وَعَلَى الْوَارِثِ, and upon the heirs of the person, مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ, is a duty like that. فَإِن, and then if أَرَادَ, both of them desire, as in the both the mother and the father, they desire, or if the father has passed away, then the heirs of the father, the whoever has inherited from that man, whoever are his inheritors, they and the mother, they decide together. فِصَالًا, then weaning, like before these two years, عن تراضٍ, through mutual consent, منهما, of both of them, وتشاورٍ, and they are with consultation, with mutual consent and consultation, like mashwara, right? So shawara, and it's the same, comes from the same root, tashawurin, so and consultation. Fala junaha alayhima, then there is no blame alayhima on both of them. Wa in, and if aradtum, you want, and to tasardiu, to ask another woman to suckle, which is here referring to a foster mother. And so if you want another woman to suckle your child for any reason, maybe the mother's milk supply has dried out or could be any other reason, then you can ask another woman to suckle. Auladakum, your child. Fala junaha alaykum, then there is no blame upon you. Like, it can be done. There is no harm in that. Ida, when sallamtum, you pay ma ataytum, what is due from you, bil ma'ruf, in a fair manner. So you can hire a foster mother or somebody to feed the child for some reason, and there's no sin upon it, but then you need to pay that person whatever has been agreed upon in that agreement. Wattaqullaha, and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa'alamu, and know, anna Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bima ta'amaluna basir, is of whatever you do, whatever amal you do, he is basir, he is all seeing of it. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, so especially in terms of divorce, and even in general, when a couple is married, they should do things in this way. But then especially in terms of divorce, what is going to happen, right? So if there is a child, and what is going to happen, so this becomes very relevant for people who are getting divorced, and there's a child involved, there's an infant involved. So mothers may breastfeed their children up to 2 years, and for whoever wishes to complete the nursing period. So what will happen during the nursing period? Obviously, the child will be with the mother. The child will stay with the mother in especially these 2 years. And upon the fall, and while the child is, so the iddat is over. So as we know that iddat is over when the woman gives birth to a child, then her if the woman is pregnant, then her iddat lasts until she gives birth. But once she gives birth, then what happens? Divorce is done, but then the child that is now newborn will stay with the mother for the whole nursing period. It won't be staying with the father, because obviously the child needs the mother at this time. And upon the father, while the child will, they're both separated, they've divorced, they're not living together anymore, they're not each other, like this guy's not her mahram anymore, so she's living away and she's the child's with her. But at this time, while she's bearing the child is still the responsibility of the father. And because she's taking care of his child, what he will do is he will bear the mother's food and clothing expenses, according to whatever is acceptable. So upon the father is the mother's provision and their clothing, according to whatever acceptable. And no person is charged more than his capacity. Neither should the mother be harmed through her child, nor the father should be harmed through the child. And upon the father's heir or his inheritor is the duty like that of a father in case he passes away, which is obviously if the father has passed away, then obviously whoever's inherited his property will be giving the money out of that to this lady to take care of the child, even if they have divorced. And if they both desire, so the father and the mother, if they both desire weaning, i.e. before the 2 year term is completed, then they can decide that through mutual consent and consultation. So it won't be just like one person's thing. They will have a consent and they'll consult in this manner. Then there is no blame upon any of them if they both agree to do it. And if you wish to have your children nursed by a substitute, by a foster mother, then there is no blame upon you. And some society, like it was a very common practice before, and it is also, it might be a practice in some cultures, not so much in other cultures, but if anybody wishes to do it, it's not something that somebody has to do it, but if somebody wishes to get the child nursed by a substitute, then there is no blame upon you as long as you give payment according to what is acceptable, because the child's with the mother, and if she has to pay a substitute mother, then the father has to give the money to the mother to be able to pay that. Like, it is not her responsibility to pay, it is the man's responsibility to pay for it. And fear Allah, and know that Allah Ta'ala is seeing of what you do. So if you don't follow this, or you use the laws of Allah to twist them for your favor, then Allah knows and He's seeing of what you do. So inshallah we'll cover these ayat in a little bit more detail. So last week we had talked about two divorces, and what we had said was that first of all, the concept of three divorces has been the way it has been presented in the media and movies and everything is completely like incorrect, let's just say. So how does Islam Islam allows for divorce? Islam doesn't encourage divorce. It is not something that is desired. It is something that should be avoided as much as possible. It should be something that is not sought. It is something that is you make things easier and easier and easier for people to stay married. And obviously we learned that shaitan loves to separate people, especially husband and wife. So marriage is something which is called half of our deen, and we try our best and to invest in our marriages and to keep our marriages. And there might be different things that we do sometimes, like patience with different things and everything, but obviously there is always a line. Like Islam does not teach us also that, like they say that if somebody slaps on one cheek, you turn the other cheek. Yes, you might do it a few times, but you don't keep doing that, right? There's a line. And after that, you don't do that anymore, right? So if there is a situation like that and people need to separate for some reason, either the man is not behaving in a right way, or if the women, and it could be both, it could be anybody, or they're just not getting along, whatever could be the reason, then divorce is permissible. And then if divorce is done, then it should be done in the right way. And Allah Ta'ala has taught us through the Quran and the Hadith what is the right way. So the right way is that there are three chances that a person has, and he does not need to take all three chances. It is a and the Prophet ﷺ told us to the effect of that, and the Sahaba said as well, that to try to get three talaqs at one time, that is a matter of jahil. A jahil person would do that. That's somebody who's not even ignorant, but who's very unwise and very, ignorant person and unwise person who has no sense, basically, on how to do things. So the thing is that divorce can be done with just one talaq. The provision of three talaq is there to give time and to give people chances, right? And like we discussed last time, that in Arab society, in Jahiliyyah society before Islam, people would give divorce to their wives, and then just before her iddat was about, and iddat was much longer, around a year, as the iddat was about to finish, they would take her back and they would torture her, they would not be nice to her and everything, and they would give her talaq again after a little bit, and then they would keep doing it hundreds of times, and there was no limit. The purpose was to keep the woman tied up, that neither am I going to be nice to you, nor am I going to let you marry somebody else. Like, you have to listen to me and serve me and whatever else was there. And there are all kinds of elements always in all societies, right? So but as a general sense, the general thing is that for a normal couple where they're both decent people, they're both good people, but they're not getting along, they have and the person pronounces one divorce, first of all he should pronounce divorce when she's not in her periods. And if she is not in her periods, then she's not had physical relationship with her after her periods have ended. If he has had relationship with her, then he should wait till other period. What does this do? This makes a man think and wait sometimes, and it is a natural human tendency that sometimes we get too angry and too hyper about something. And then when we cool down, we realize, no, things are not as bad. And sometimes shaitan makes us put waswasa in our minds, and then there's a lot of negativity in something. But when we cool down, we're like, no, things are the other way around, right? So people cool down everything. So in the stages of divorce, there's a lot of time which is given and a lot of time to cool down for people to think of the positives. And it's easy to see that the mistake of a spouse, he does this or she does this, or he's bad with this or she's bad with this. But there are a lot of positives as well. And sometimes what happens for us is, as human beings, we have a tendency to ignore the 99 positives but focus on that one negative. And Allah Ta'ala teaches us that he gives us time to be able to think of the positives and to be able to think that, look, he takes care of your needs and she does this for you and everything. Then don't be hasty with her. So the first divorce, there is a waiting period. And the person said, pronounce the divorce, and then there's a waiting period of 3 months. Or if she's pregnant, then until she is done. Then just before her thing ends, her, and he does not need to say it again at all. He just said it once and that's good enough. And if they still want to separate by the end of the time of Iddah, she's still living with him, she's still his wife, she can still do everything to please him, to apologize if there has been any mistakes or things like that and try to make up or whatever else. The divorce is not done yet. He said the divorce, but there is a waiting period of these 3 months. And if these 3 months are over and he does not take her back, does not take back the divorce, it's a revocable divorce, and he does not take it back, then the divorce will be done at the end of the iddat, the waiting period. And once the divorce is done, now they're not married anymore. It's been one divorce, but they're not married anymore. But what does it mean with one divorce? He still can propose to her and get married again. He has an option open. They have an option open to marry each other again. And supposing that happens, they marry, the same procedure happens again, they get divorced again. Now the second divorce has happened. This is not the first divorce now, this is the second divorce. And the second divorce can also be revoked during the iddat period. And after the second divorce, once they separate and everything, 1 year passes, they miss each other, whatever, he proposes, she accepts, then they are allowed to remarry again. But if this happens again the third time, that is what is meant by triple talaq, the third talaq. The third talaq is irrevocable. Once he said it again the third time, khalas, during the iddat period, he has to take care of her during the iddat period, and but he cannot take back the divorce. He cannot revoke it during the iddat period. He does not have that right anymore. He's done it twice. This is the third time. They've had their iddat periods before, and this is the third time iddat. No more. No more waiting time for her. And once the iddat time is ended, then the divorce is finalized. And what's the wisdom behind this? And during the iddat period, the divorce is not yet finalized. What does that mean? That means that during this iddat period, in case the husband dies, something happens, she is still technically his wife and she'll be one of the inheritors, right? So there's a wisdom about things. So it's not just that thing. So the divorce is done, but it is comes into effect on the time that she becomes legally divorced. He and they become legally divorced once the third talaq is done and they are totally separated, and now he cannot send a proposal to him. Now he cannot marry her again. The only option now, but again, our religion is based on practicality, and there might be situations there that are very unique. And again, Islam is a religion meant for people from the time of the Prophet ﷺ to the end of times, for all cultures, all societies, all people, all generations and everything. And there are different scenarios that will arise at different times, right? And Islam takes into account all kinds of scenarios that might arise. So what happens? If what happens is that this woman that she had divorced, after the third talaq is done, now she cannot, they too cannot remarry and everything. But what does Islam encourage? Islam encourages people to marry. And because marriage is good and pure, because it takes care of all of our needs and desires in a halal way, in a way that is desired and everything. So now it is lawful for her to marry, and she can marry now anybody. If she decides to marry somebody other than him, right? And they get married. But this person that she married now, the second husband, for some reason, either a divorce happens with this person. And again, it could be the first divorce. It doesn't have to be the three divorces. It could be the first divorce and a divorce happens, or the second husband dies and she is by herself alone. Now she has lived with another person. She has had experience about the other person. And sometimes what happens is when we've lived with another person, then we realize, you know what, actually I had a very dreamy image of what I wanted, but you know, actually there were a lot of qualities in the first husband that she did not realize before. And the first husband as well realizes that, you know, she got married to somebody else and everything, and I really missed her, or I did realize that I actually did love her a lot and everything. And sometimes a bit of distance puts that love back in people. Sometimes people, friction happens and things happen between people, but then they're away for a little bit, they realize that no, they do belong together and everything. And if that happens, then this first husband now can again propose to her. This is the one exceptional case that she will become halal to him again. Otherwise, she's not halal to him anymore. Three divorces have happened. No way, she's not. But then she's lived with somebody else. Now she's had another husband. She's had two husbands and marriages. She's had two marriages and everything. And now for her, it's not very easy for her now to marry somebody else, right? Because it's like a woman gets much emotionally invested as well in a relationship and everything. It's not easy for her. And she's like, rather than going to a new person, what if the first person has proposed, and what if I return to that person? And she considers it, and she wants it. Then there is no harm upon it. Then that's the only reason, only way that it is allowed for the first husband to marry her again. But it will again be a proper marriage. He will send her a proposal. She'll accept it. They will get a proper wedding as if they've never been married before. As in, like, they would be married like that. But again, now that they're married, he does not get three chances again. No, that is already done. But this is an exceptional case when they can get married and everything. And the other condition is, first condition is to have her halal, is that that she's married somebody else and that second husband passed away. And the other condition is that both of them, when they're returning to each other, their purpose of returning to each other is to observe the limits of Allah Ta'ala, as in they will, if there was a lot of shouting and lot of friction and a lot of arguments happening in the house before, now they say, no, this time we'll be changed people. We will be kind to each other. We will take care of each other. We'll value each other, and we will try to, and there might be children involved as well. So when there are children involved, then it might be easier for the woman to return back to the father and everything. So there might be a lot of different scenarios. But if they go back, the whole thing is that their purpose is to observe the limits of Allah. And what are the limits of Allah? He has made them very clear to people who seek knowledge, who know, and who seek to know, right? So what do we learn from this ayah, right? So first thing is that if we look at our society and a lot of things that happen around us, a lot of people misuse the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for example, the concept of halala. What have people done with the concept of halal, right? The purpose of this command, that a woman who's not halal for you anymore can be halal for you in this one situation, exceptional situation that happens if she marries somebody else and that divorce happened or something. The purpose was that you don't make divorce a plaything to harass women, and you think 100 times before pronouncing divorce, because then she's free to marry somebody else. Would you be able to tolerate that? So value her. Itself. So men are being told to value her. But what a lot of people do have started doing was, and we see that in some of our societies, may Allah Ta'ala protect us from it, which they call halana nowadays, is that a person marries a woman and then divorces her. Right, the purpose of that marriage, this marriage to a divorced woman, is only to divorce her. And this whole arrangement, which is a halala, is done in order to give a legal cover for the previous husband to marry her again. So the purpose of marriage to the second husband is like they decide, okay, we'll be married for we'll get her married to this another man for a week. Like the husband would say, okay, now you're not halal to me anymore. So what I want you to do is I'll get you married to my friend, and you'll be his wife for a week or something, or two nights or whatever, and then he will divorce you, and then I can marry you again, because then I get halal. And a lot of times women are forced into it by either their previous husbands or either their families or other people, in the name of honor of the family or whatever things they call. But the thing is, this is halala, and this is not a marriage. This is not a normal marriage. And how is it different? A halala is usually, if people do these kind of things, and may Allah protect them from us, and in some of the societies today it is done, especially in our Indian Pakistani subcontinent, we see that, and may Allah protect us. That what now? But then it is important for us to understand what is the difference between a nikah and a halala. Halala is usually hidden. It's not like the woman would be forced into it and she'd be done into secrecy and everything. But a normal wedding, the elan is required, that you declare it, that you're married and everything. In a halala, there'll be no walima or anything, right? So in a normal wedding, there'll be a walima. There's an after wedding feast and everything that is given to people. And there are gifts that are given and taken and everything. In a halala, there's no gifts or everything. It is a secret marriage that is done for a purpose of just making something halal for yourself. And you, and a halala is done with the purpose of breaking a home, with the purpose of that, or okay, a divorce will be given in a day or a week or whatever. But a normal wedding, a normal nikah, is done for the purpose of establishing a house, right? And it is not time bound. A normal wedding is like the purpose is to have that wedding forever. You don't You don't look for divorce and you don't plan for a divorce. If it happens, it happens for some reasons, if reasons are unavoidable, but it's never time bound. A normal wedding is not time bound that you have this much wedding and everything. A normal wedding is done to have more children, to have progeny. That is one of the aims of marriages. And we'll have children and we'll have a family together and everything. And a woman is respected and a woman's permission is taken in that. Right. And a lot of times in halala, a woman's forced into this, that no, you have to do this and everything. And so it is something that was that Allah Ta'ala gave a right or a condition in order to protect the woman is twisted and used to abuse the woman. Right. So that what are people doing? They're going against the limits of Allah Ta'ala. The purpose was something else and you're using it for something else. And in a normal marriage, you look for similarities, you look for financial and social statuses, you look for religion and everything. But in a halala, nothing's like, okay, this man is free and he'll keep it secret, so you need to go to her and everything, right? And in a normal marriage, mahar is given, that a man would give the wife a mahar, which is like a token of money that they both agree on, and then that he will give. And a mahar is a necessary condition of a nikah. But in halala, no mahar is decided or given. In fact, a man is paid basically to have this short-term marriage with this girl. And a normal wedding is a time of happiness, and a woman is dressed up and family gets together and like husband pays for things and stuff like that. But in a halala, obviously nothing of this did that, right? And if the purpose is so different, then how are they alike? They're not alike. A halala, the way we see things in it is practiced, is very different from a nikah. And then they're not similar, right? And it is not that this is a way to get them to be halal to each other again. No, Allah Ta'ala never gives a command which never ever is any command given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala which borders of on indecency or something which is indecent by nature or vulgar by nature or has sexual innuendos by nature, right? And another thing is, when the man has given pronounced divorce to the woman, then why it is not the woman should not be made to suffer because of it, just because a man has given divorce to her, right? And if the another thing is, it also tells a man that if after second divorce, if you've said divorce second time only and a marriage can happen to the first husband again, then then you don't need to go to third divorce and make it all more the whole situation so complicated for yourself and everything. Understand things and don't act like irrationally, that you know some people just say that they pronounce and they keep saying it. They say I give you this thing, a divorce, not just once, twice, but 1,000 times, and I don't want to see you again and this and that. Like, have a control on your tongue and your anger. Allah Ta'ala has given a man this right, and he's given a level above, as in he's not given this right to a woman, because women are emotional by nature and sometimes they say things that they don't really mean. But a man, he's given him this right, so have some control on your tongue and on your emotions and your anger, and be kind and gentle and think 100 times before you say these things or before you pronounce a divorce. And the rulings that Allah Ta'ala has given us, he has given us very clear rulings, right? And when Quran comes, and our purpose is to understand the Quran and to implement the Quran. Our purpose is not just to recite the Quran and be happy with like, okay, I just know the recitation and that is no. Allah Ta'ala gives us instructions to the Quran. Allah Ta'ala tells us what to do in different situations, in social situations, in a marriage situation, in a political situation, in a financial transaction. And we learn different guidelines for different things in the Quran as we do. Go ahead and everything, right? And a living contract that is for a fixed time period is called a muta. That was a kind of marriage that was done in the Jahiliya times before Islam, but it is forbidden in Islam. And for halala, the Prophet ﷺ said to the effect of that anybody who does halala and who arranges halala, who facilitates this, both of them are cursed, right? And the Prophet ﷺ used this word very sparingly, that he would say that this person is cursed, right? So which shows it's such a big deal. But may Allah Ta'ala protect us, that many Muslims don't even think it's such a big deal and everything, right? And the purpose is that when there's a difference in the second and the third talaq and the first talaq, and that's what we understand through these things. And the purpose is, another thing is that when we understand the laws of Islam and the wisdom behind the laws of Islam, and then we understand that the purpose of Islam is, when if there is a fire that happens, then try to extinguish that fire. Don't put fuel into that fire. Don't increase that fire. Another thing is that muta or halala is a form of zina, is a form of adultery, is a form of is not nikah. That is, you're playing with the girl's body and emotions, and it is not something that is preferable. In fact, that is something like making fun of the limits of Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. That is transgressing the limits of Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. And if we there is a wisdom, subhanAllah, even in these ayat coming after the whole passage that we learned in Surah Baqarah about Bani Israel. Because what did they used to do? They used to twist the words. They used to twist the commands. What did they do with this instead of Sabbath? Right? Allah Ta'ala told them that you can't do any business or anything. Saturday, you should dedicate it to your worship and everything. And they would say, they would fish and everything, and then when somebody would tell them that it is Saturday, you shouldn't do it, then what they would do is they would put the nets on a Friday night and everything, and take it out on Sunday, that the fishes would come. They would make wells, they would dig wells or things near the shore and put nets in it, and then the fishes would fall down and put nets in it on Friday, and fishes would fall in it on Saturday. But they're like, we were not doing anything, it was the nets were there, we were not fishing. And then Sunday they would take it out and they would say, no, see, we didn't do it anything on Saturday. But they were what were they doing? Allah Ta'ala gave them a command and they understood the command, and yet they tried to basically use this in order to, they twisted the command of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, and they tried to show that they're following it, although they were not following it, right? And the intention of this command, that for a woman being halal after marrying another person, was that if a woman with her own free will marries another person in a recognized way with no condition of divorce superimposed on it, and then if after this marriage the second husband divorces her or dies, then she can remarry the first husband, because that might be easier for her, because she's in a very unique situation, it might be very might be much easier for her, right? So that was the condition. And those who ignore the commands of Allah, they should understand the law and the spirit of law, of Islamic law. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the next ayah that when you have, and it is being addressed to the Muslim men, that when you have divorced the woman and they have approached their waiting period, when their waiting period is about to end, which means either 3 months or the end of delivery time, that if she was pregnant, then either retain them with fairness or release them with fairness. And do not retain them with a wrongful intent, right? Don't think about being cruel to her. Yes, Allah Ta'ala has given you a thing, and yes, you can get away sometimes in the name of law, or by twisting the law or something, or by by misleading people or doing something else, or just because she doesn't have anybody else to go or something else to do, then or even in society, nobody might hold you accountable and everything. Even her own family might be like a bit more, maybe they're not that well off or something, or maybe there's some problem or whatever else, then you might be able to get away with it. But don't do this wrongfully, right? And you can obviously, the time to take her back or to revoke is only for the first two divorces. So now here we're talking about all the situation, right? So if it has been the first talaq or it has been the second talaq, and they're approaching the end of waiting period, and when you can take it back, then do it with fairness or release them with fairness. If you really don't want to live with her, that's okay. You don't have to hate her still. Just let her go. You marry somebody else, she can marry somebody else. It's not the end of the world. But don't retain her to kind of like, okay, now I'll get back to you, or this thing, and I didn't like this. So I'm so don't oppress her now, right? And oppression is not something that is not allowed. Don't keep her trapped for the purpose of torturing her. And another point of releasing her with fairness is, don't badmouth her. Yes, a divorce has happened, but whenever a divorce happens, obviously people didn't get along. Obviously they didn't see eye to eye about some things and everything, or something happened which you didn't like about each other, something. But then don't badmouth her. just because your relationship has finished, she might have some good qualities, she might not have some, but you don't have to keep talking about it. You don't have to start backbiting about her. You don't have to keep spreading lies about her, or even if it's the truth, you don't need to backbite about her. Just let her go. Like, it's not your matter anymore. You're not married anymore, so it's fine. Just let her go. And it was said before, but this matter is repeated again, that previously it was said that use ihsan in one of the previous ayah that we done before, that if the waiting period has not come, then keep her or release her with ihsan, right? So now here it is being said bil ma'ruf, like if you can't reach the level of ihsan, at least do be fair. At least be, if you're not a person who is like, who can be like so much or be so good in your things, and different people are different kinds, then at least do something which is ma'ruf, do something which is good, and do something which is correct and everything, right? And these are private social issues. So we are being reminded again and again in these private social issues that fear Allah Ta'ala, because it is the fear of Allah that will help us to follow this. When a man can get away with this, it is the fear of Allah that will help her to do this, right? And another thing just to reiterate here is that matters related to marriage and divorce and everything, we are learning here as a general guideline in a normal circumstances of everything. But if it is a very special circumstance or something, then we have to seek an opinion by a specialist. Like, for example, if somebody has a medical condition and they have a heart problem or something, they would go to a heart specialist. They would not go to a pediatrician, or they would not go to an ENT or a ear, nose and throat specialist, or they wouldn't go to a foot doctor to talk about a heart specialist. We will go to the right specialist, right? And even in matters of deen, there are specialists of different guys. There's a mufti, there's a faqih, there's like different people who have specialized in fiqh and in like in science or in medicine. You study a certain level, everybody studies that, and then after that there are specialization. So even in deen, people study to a certain level, and then there are specializations in different areas. And when we need to seek an opinion which is a complicated situation or something, then a specialist should be sought for, and then opinion taken from them, right? So what we are learning here are very general guidelines which people should be aware of so that they can handle their situations in normal day-to-day circumstances, right? And another thing is the kitab refers to the book, and hadith, wisdom, refers to the hadith, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us both, right? And he has helped us with, decreed for both of them to be preserved for us, the people who are not living in the time of the Prophet. Alhamdulillah, the people living at the time of the Prophet, they had the privilege of asking the Prophet directly whenever they had a confusion, they didn't understand anything, or they wanted more information about something. And but for us who are not living in that time, Alhamdulillah, we have the Quran and the Hadith that have been preserved by the previous generations for us, right? And if we want Allah Ta'ala to be pleased with us, if we want things, then we should try to understand. Every average Muslim should try to understand the Quran and Hadith and try their best to implement it and follow it properly. So what does following it properly mean? Like, for example, and follow it all the time. Like, for example, people say they care for their mom. And what does that mean? Caring for your mom means that you listen to her and you respect her at all times. It doesn't mean that you just celebrate her birthday and the whole year you don't even care what she's doing and everything, right? But on her birthday, you like shower her with gifts and this and that. So deen is not like that. It's for 24/7, right? It's for all the time. And Allah Ta'ala gives us nasihat through this. He's like, he instructs you. Ya'idhukum. Allah Ta'ala gives us a nasihat through this book and through the hikmah. It is not just meant for barakah and adornment. You just don't carry the book and you're like, I'm just reading the Quran for sabab and everything. And we hear that from some people. May Allah Ta'ala protect us, that it's not just for sabab. Quran tells you how to live your life. And it will, if you allow it to, and it's a reminder to myself first, that if we learn from the Quran and then we try to mold our lives according to the Quran day by day, more and more and slowly, subhanAllah, Allah Ta'ala has not put us accountable for things that we didn't know. But as we come to know something, as we come to understand something, then we start to implement it together, then it is recommended, right? And then we understand that, and that's the way of life that a Muslim should lead. Yeah. Another thing is that Allah Ta'ala knows everything. whose mistake was it? Why did the family break up? Why do people break up? And people always talk about their own versions of the story, but Allah Ta'ala knows exactly what happened between the two of you. So fear Him. Things might have happened in your private that nobody else knows about, but if you fear Allah Ta'ala, then you wouldn't play the blame game, and you wouldn't go into all this like name smearing each other and everything. And greater the fear of Allah in a man's heart, and greater his knowledge about Allah's commands, then a person will be saved from disobeying Allah Ta'ala. Because there are two things. When these two things are combined, first you fear Allah, and second you start to have more and more knowledge about what does Allah want, then obviously it will save you, because you would not want to go against that, right? And here Allah Ta'ala says that if a man does injustice on the woman, if he transgresses the rights, then he's doing dhulm upon himself. How is it a dhulm on himself? Because he may appear to be targeting a woman who seems helpless and everything, but by doing this, using the commands of Allah Ta'ala in an incorrect spirit or in an incorrect way, but just legally satisfying it, you know, what a person's doing, he's making a mockery of the divine law, and he's violating the divine law, and he's making a mockery of it at the same time. How so? Because a person claims to follow the dictates of any religion, because he's like, see, I'm so religious, I'm following this, in order to what? In order to silence any critics. Because any critic cannot say anything, because you're like, oh, I did everything by the book. This is how I did it. While at the same time, the same person, although he's like creating this facade that he's following the dictates of religion, while at the same time, this person is actively opposing and undermining the very purpose of the law that they're using for their own benefit, right? So they're only pretending, in effect, what are they doing? They're only pretending to observe and respect the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is a big injustice on themselves. They're not just oppressing this woman. They are they're doing a crime, not just against this other woman, but they're also doing a crime against the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And how is one of the ways that people could be doing this injustice is, for example, revoking a divorce, if it's a first divorce or a second divorce, revoking it just with the intention of trapping the woman and or hurting the woman, or or being bullying her, or any things like that. If somebody does that, then they're using the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the face of it, to the world, they're like, no, I'm like, you know what, I'll forgive her and this and that. And anybody who looks the couple, you're like, this man is so understanding and he's like so nice to her, and he'll have this whole image created that, you know what, I wanted to divorce, but then I would take her back and everything. But in the privacy, and he creates this whole image that this woman is like, so ungrateful, and this woman is like that. But in the privacy, the story is totally something else, and it is very much possible. We know enough of the real world that we've seen things that not everything that we see is as how it is. Right? A lot of people do this. And what happens to the people who obey Allah? They know more about Allah, they fear Allah, and they obey Allah. For the other group of people who do this, who are twisting the commands of Allah, or using the commands of Allah for an unjust purpose, the purpose what they were not there for, right? As for these wicked ones, what is happening with them? They are being given some ample respite in their life. They're being given some time in their life to do what? To reform and mend their ways. Allah Ta'ala has given them time. You did something wrong? Correct your ways and come back to think. But they're doing dhulm on themselves, they will definitely be called to account and punished on the Day of Judgment. If they don't, this is the thing they're doing to themselves, and Allah Ta'ala will not let, He tells us elsewhere in the Quran that He wouldn't let an atom's worth of good deed or oppression go unchecked, and it will all be open to us on the Day of Judgment. Then Allah Ta'ala tells us that if you divorce the woman and they complete their time, then don't prevent them, don't withhold them, don't debar them, don't interfere, don't become an obstacle for them to marry somebody else, right? And there's an incident that is narrated with respect to this ayah, that there was a person, there was one of the Sahaba, his name was Maqal ibn Yasar. Okay, Maqal ibn Yasar. So he married his sister to a man, and this man, they got divorced. He said divorce to her. So it was one divorce, right? The one divorce was done, and that period finished, and he did not revoke the divorce in that time. And then basically she came home. The divorce is done now, but it is one divorce which was done. So after some time, what this man did, what the first husband did, was he sent a proposal. He sent a proposal to be married again to this girl because he started missing her or whatever. And in the meantime, she had other proposals as well, like some other people proposed her to her. And subhanAllah, that was a very salient feature of that society, that if somebody got divorced or widowed after that period ended, people would rush to marry that woman to be able to support that woman. And it was not the concept of a single person being there for a long time was not a very natural thing, and there was no stigma attached to a divorced woman or a widowed woman. And subhanAllah, our Prophet himself married divorced and widowed women to tell us that there is no stigma attached to that, right? And a woman should be given a home, and people in the society, they should take care of women. So anyway, she had different proposals, Makkal's sister, and she also got a proposal from her first husband. And she desired to return to the first husband rather than any other suitors at that time. But Makkal got really angry. He said, I got my sister divorced, married to you, and you divorced her. And now, you know what, I will never, and he's like, I swear I'll never marry my sister to you again. And you didn't value her, and you didn't do that, and this and that, and everything. So basically he said this. And then this ayah came down. But when this ayah came down, that you cannot stop them, what did Makkal do? He said, no, well, khalas. This ayah, he understood that, and he said, no, I can't stop you now. You can go and marry. And you two can get married, and they got married again, right? And only one more divorce was done, so they could remarry again. They were not, it was not three divorces or anything, so they could get remarried again. So and what we learn from this ayah, one thing is that it is a girl's right to consent to whoever she wants to get married to, right? And she wanted to get married to him. So then her brother, or for our times, her family, they should not stop her. If they can get married again, don't think about social stigma and this and that. Yes, they were married before. And if Islam allows them to remarry again and they both desire that, then allow them that. Don't stand in their way. Another thing is, for a woman, a lot of times for men, they feel, oh, this is the worst man, and you know, like he has this bad habits, and I don't like him and everything. But the fact of the matter is that once she leaves the house and goes back to her own family, and she's lived with her husband, she's been married for a while, and she goes and lives with her own brother or her mother and everything, then what she realizes, in many, many cases, we will find that, you know, the sorrow or the pain or the hardships at the husband's house, when a woman is married and living with a husband, are much more bearable than even the pleasures when you are living at your own house after that, right? So it's something very natural. This happens. So one thing that we learn is that without any big reason, for small things, we should not try to create things between husband and wife, and not do that. And then another thing we learn from this incident is that Sahabas were also human beings like us. They had emotions too. They had like egos and ghira too, right? Like the brother did get a bit offended, like, why should I get, and everything. And that is a natural emotion. But one thing was that they had normal emotions like people in our times have too, but it was their character and commitment to Islam that as soon as the ayah was revealed, Makkal immediately let his sister get back to her husband. No, okay, if I thought that, but once Allah or a Rasul says something, then khalas, I submit to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? They would do their islah right away. They would change their stand right away on things, right? And so a heart of a person who believes, what is like a the scholar says, like a compass. Wherever Allah turns it, you turn there. So when Allah tells you pray, you pray. When Allah tells you you can't pray, you don't pray. When Allah tells you go for Hajj, you go for Hajj. When it is Hudaybiyah and people have walked for so long, their feet are bleeding and everything, and the incident of the Hudaybiyah, and Allah Ta'ala and Rasulullah decide that no, we will not, we've come all this way, but we'll go right from the entry of Makkah, we'll go back and we will not do Umrah, sorry, this year, and we'll come back next year. The Sahaba, They agree, right? And that is what a believer's heart is, that your heart wants something else so bad, whether it's your heart, your emotions, or this and that, even if the thing is for the sake of Allah. But then if Allah Ta'ala tells you something else, you follow that, you do that. And in the submit, what is Islam? Islam is submission to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala as well, right? And another thing that we learn here is that, Allah's commands that we understand only a little bit of some things, and there will be things, and we learned that from the beginning of the surah itself, Alif Lam Mim. Our knowledge is very limited. It is not universal, and we don't have a broad view concerning all real advantages in any situation, right? There are man-made laws of family laws, and there are family laws presented by the Quran. And the family laws presented by the Quran are devised by the all-knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the one who has the most wisdom, right? And therefore, they are based on these laws that Allah ta'ala gives. They are based on the principles that are really good for us. They're actually good for us, and they're truly advantageous. So when we learn the commands has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we follow that, because that is the true command, right? And another thing here is that we should be optimistic and look ahead. Something bad has happened before, but doesn't mean that it will continue to be bad. Maybe people have learned their lessons. People learn their lessons. People, and as human beings, we do wrong by other people and ourselves as well sometimes. And if, for example, when we are driving, we look in the rear view mirror sometimes for reference, but we focus on the front mirror, right? We look ahead. So Islam teaches us to be optimistic. Yes, some mistakes might have happened by two people before, but if they genuinely want and they are genuinely willing to give it a try again, then look ahead and be optimistic that yes, this time they will work out. Yes, I mean, it is not the end of the world, but be optimistic about it. Another thing, as we said here, is that interpretation of this is that if a woman has reached her, and that is one of the beauty of the Quran, that one ayah can be interpreted in different ways and all of it makes sense in different situations, and different all situations make sense, subhanAllah. That if she's married just for the first husband and she's divorced, and then now if she wants to marry the divorce is done, that is over, and she wants to marry somebody else, then the first husband should not try to create obstacles in her way or everything. No, she used to be my wife. How can I? It is like a purpose of my honor. How can I let her get married to somebody else or this and that? Don't try to prevent her, right? She is free. She's not your wife anymore. She can contract a marriage in a usual and accepted way, of course, in a correct way, not a timely marriage, not a things like that. And you have no right to stand in her way in deciding what she wants, what she considers best for herself. If somebody proposes and she likes that proposal, she wants to go ahead, then the previous husband has no right to stop that. And what Allah Ta'ala tells us is in the laws that Allah Ta'ala has given us, there is this clean, there is purity for us. There is these laws are more virtuous, and these are the laws which are cleaner, both externally and internally. And there are unnecessary and superficial rituals and customs and egos and people, if they create hindrance in her remarriage, then what will happen? She wants to get married, whether she wants to get married to the first husband or whether she wants to get married to another man. If people create in the name of ego, in the name of some rituals or our family, we don't do this, or our custom is like this, or maybe she wants to get married to somebody who's younger than her, or whatever reasons. There are many reasons in different societies, and people try to stop that. Then what will happen? There's a danger of them going astray and committing immoral acts. There's a danger of secret liaisons. There's a danger of adultery. There's a danger of abduction. There's a danger of running away from home. There's a lot of ills of the society that might happen. And in the end, what happens if things like this happen? Everybody is a loser. The society loses as a whole. And in a zeal to uphold like family honor, people sometimes they create unnatural barriers. And what do these barriers do? They curb natural human instincts. A natural human instinct of both man and woman is to have a healthy marriage in which they love, care, and support each other. And they're able to, if Allah Ta'ala blesses them with children, they are able to raise their children. They are able to do things with their children. They are able to care for other human beings and raise human beings in that environment. And with that, Allah Ta'ala tells us what happens while raising the children, while taking care of the children is, first of all, Allah Ta'ala mentioned that the mothers should suckle their 2 years. The first thing is the importance of mothers. And there is so much that can be said about the importance of mothers in Islam, right? The honor and respect of a woman in terms of being a mother. And what we are learning here is a child should be suckled for 2 years. And it is so beautiful that a human being's, before even a human being comes into this world, Allah Ta'ala already takes care of the risk of that child, of every human being. He took care of my risk. He took care of your risk. He takes care of the risk of every single human being. First of all, in the womb of the mother. We don't even ask. We are a child. We are an infant. We don't know anything, but Allah Ta'ala provides us there, right? Through the umbilical cord, through whatever the mother eats and everything. The child is taken care of. And as soon as the child is born, the risk of the child is already given in the mother's chest, right? The risk is already given, and Allah Ta'ala prepares it. Like if we go through the biology of it and everything, it is so beautiful how Allah Ta'ala prepares a mother's body. And it is so complicated. And the more complicated it is, the more we realize that it cannot be by chance. It is something that Allah Ta'ala has created it, right? And sometimes people don't use or look at something for the purpose that it is and misuse what they have. So nowadays we find that a lot of times we find it in today's day and age that some women feel that their chest or their body is just for curves of the body and they don't need to feed their children, right? And so many people, they just don't want to feed their children, and they can, everything's okay, like there's no physical issue and everything, but they're like, no, I don't want to do this, and it's my body, and I don't want to feed the child and this, like this and that. But the thing is, Allah Ta'ala has put the risk of that child in the chest and everything. And when this part of the body has been, if you look at advertisements, if you look at media, if you look at magazines, this part of the body of a woman has been exposed excessively around us, right? And what did Allah Ta'ala tell us? Allah Ta'ala tells us to hide it. Like with the hijab, Allah Ta'ala tells us that put your headscarf on top of your chest, hide this part, because there is, Allah Ta'ala has put, there's no doubt about it, there he has put an attraction in this part of a woman's body, and that's why Allah Ta'ala told us to cover it up, because there is an attraction there and you cannot deny it. You can't be unrealistic about it, that no, I'm like, no, it does attract other people, so you hide it. And there is a purpose to this as well, that when you have a child and everything, then you use your body for that purpose. And we understand that about each part of our body. Like as human beings, we understand that our nose is meant to smell, our ears are meant to listen, our mouth is meant to speak, our we know all this. But it's only when it comes to the organs of our body, which are of a sensual nature or a sexual nature, that our society tends to forget that thing at all, right? And it is used nowadays a lot to buy other people's iman or to sell your own iman, right? For the women and the men nowadays. So, with the mother and what a lot of scholars of our previous time, they taught us that when a woman feeds a child, it's not just the feeding. It is like a lot of emotional attachment as well. It is a lot of thing, right? So, like you get attached to the child and everything. And even if you think about it, the child is in a certain position in the womb. And when a mother holds the child, after the child's born, when the mother holds the child to feed the child from her own chest, then what happens is the child is in the same similar position. The body of the child is in a similar position. It is a position of security. It is a position in which we take the baby in our lap and then the mother feeds them, or in her hands, and then she feeds them, right? And we see often, like if we actually pay attention to a mother, a new mother and a child, we'll see that if a mother is feeding the child, then in just 3-4 gulps, we'll see that the child looks very peaceful now. And the child goes to sleep easily and everything, as opposed to using a feeder and everything. Of course, when there is some reason and there is that they need to do it, then they need to do it. But it is this, we're talking about a situation when everything's fine and they can, the mother can feed the child, but she chooses not to or anything, right? So as opposed to this, if a child's put in a cradle and given a hard feeder, then the child doesn't feel that secure, right? That feeling of security and everything. So a mother is, and subhanAllah, Allah Ta'ala has put, given the womb, the name of the womb of the mother, the same root as his own name, Ar-Rahman, right? So the inner lining of the womb of a mother is called Rahm. And the role of a mother is to provide security, to provide like comfort, and to provide, to take care of the child and everything. And one of the first ways that this relationship gets established is through the feeding of the child, right? And subhanAllah, a lot of times in today's days, we've made the moms so busy making themselves hands-free, in a sense, and that mother is gone and the child's being taken care of somebody else. And then what happens is there's no, and that's just the beginning of it. And then throughout, we see that the parents don't spend time with the children, or they don't take care of children. And then when they become old, they cry that the children have put them in old age homes, right? How is it that different? Because what you sow, so shall you reap, right? You didn't pay attention to that. And Allah Ta'ala made us, He gave us this book. And he shows us these things, and he tells us what to do and everything, which is, and today, even if we listen to science, it tells us now that we should, we should feed our child and everything. Then we listen to the science very quickly. We see that a lot of people, if science says something, they're like, oh, yeah. You know, this is the new research says this, we should follow this now. But if Allah Ta'ala's command is there and Hikmah is there, until it is proven by science, some people feel reluctant to it. But when science agrees with it, they're like, oh, yeah, there's a scientific thing behind it. Okay, we'll do it. But subhanAllah, until you knew the science, what is submission? Because if you understood the logic behind something and only then you're submitting to it, then you're not submitting to the command of Allah, you're submitting to the logic then, right? So our thing is that we understand that Allah knows more. And once I come to know that, then I'll submit myself, and I will do what Allah Ta'ala asks me to do, right? And again, we know a lot of benefits of the mother's milk as well. There's a lot of antibodies that are there, and the fresh milk, it is easily digestible. It's not stale anymore. It is right fresh. And we know that the consistency of the mother's milk changes as the child grows up. So it is very thin in the beginning, and it becomes thicker as the child grows, and it becomes more filling as the child grows. So it molds itself, it changes itself according to the age of the child and the needs of the child. Another thing is whether it's a boy, the child is a boy or a girl, it'll be the same period. There is no difference in how much time you feed a boy or a girl. It is the same time period. And the full time is 2 years. They can do before as well. They can wean a child before as well for any other reason, but not more than 2 years. Why not more than 2 years? Because after 2 years, the teeth are there. And after that, if we keep doing that, then the child won't get into the habit of eating, because now they start to eat a lot more. They need to eat a lot more, right? Another reason is that now the child has become much more conscious at 2 years of age. So there's a modesty as well of the mother. And another reason could be that the woman might be pregnant again, and she might be expecting again, and then it might be too hard for her to basically feed and be pregnant and take care of everything. There are multiple demands on her body at that time, right? So that is the wisdom behind. But if a divorce happens when a mother is nursing, or while she was pregnant and now she has an infant, then Islam tells us the child will stay the mom for this period of time, at least for sure. And the father will pay for the mother and the child. He will meet his responsibility according to the acceptable manner, meaning according to his financial status. So a rich person will give more to his wife. It's not like you'll give $100 and you earn like $100,000 a year and you're like, no, I'll just give you $100. No, whatever you afford in a reasonable manner. A poor person, he has little bit, he gives from that. A rich person, he has more, he gives from that. So everybody gives according to, bil ma'ruf here means according to his means, according to what is there. And the mother can ask, okay, I need this much. And then they can talk to each other and they can decide, right? So the food and clothing of the mother will be taken care of by the father. And in this case, neither the mother nor the father, they should not trouble each other. Like in giving that money, the father should not harass the mother. He should not be like, don't trouble her just because you have to interact with her, even though you've divorced. She's still a human being. She might not be your wife anymore. She's still the mother of your child. And so be nice to her. And whatever is due to her, give her easily. Don't make things hard for her, right? Also for a woman, like, and Islam is a just religion for both parties, not just for one. For a woman, don't demand from the guy if more than he can afford, right? You know his financial situation. You know what is easy for him, what is not easy for him. Then don't just say, okay, you know what, I want $1 million. Like, if he can't afford it, how will he give? He has his own expenses too. So be considerate in that sense. So neither party should harm each other. No soul is burdened beyond their capacity, meaning neither should the mother be harmed, nor should the father be harmed. And if for some reason a man passes away, then whoever are his inheritors, if a man passes away, then his brothers, let's say, inherit his wealth, then those brothers will meet this commitment for those 2 years, right? Whoever inherits this man's money will pay from this money to the mother. And if he's alive, obviously what they'll do is they'll both decide together and how much should be paid and everything. And for some reason, if the milk supply stopped, or if any other reason, if they have to wean before 2 years, or the mother can't feed anymore, and they both agree and do they take each other's opinion. So first of all, they take each other's opinion. There's no dictatorship in Islam. There's no like, I said so and that is how it's going to be. Neither the man nor the woman should say that. They have a child together. They should consult each other, and they should do things with consultation. There's khair and mashwara, right? We should do. We've been told in our religion to do istikhara and mashwara, to always seek first of all seek khair from Allah Ta'ala and do mashwara from other believers, and then go ahead, right? Opinions of both are important, and then if they both decide that they'll have a foster mother, and Arabs had a culture of foster mother. Even our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had a foster mother, Halima Siddiqa, right? And so the thing is that if in some cultures there's this trend, or if the father and mother decide, even if it's not their cultural practice, they want to do that, and a foster mother is hired, then the mother should be given the money that is paid to the foster mother and everything, so that she can take care of that as well, right? And the end of all this, what is the gist of all of this, learning all these laws and everything is right, but the way or the reason why somebody would follow it would still go back to the same thing that we learned in the beginning of Suratul Baqarah itself, right? The Dhalikal Kitabul Araybafi Hudalil Muttaqeen. Does this book has guidance? But who will use these guidance? Those who fear Allah. And the taqwa of Allah Ta'ala is, and we keep listening to this again and again, whenever ahkam of Allah comes, it is the taqwa of Allah that will help us in doing things. And one small point is that if the father and mother don't agree on something, they have a difference of opinion and they have a friction amongst them and they don't agree about something, then the matter can be taken to a family court or a family committees for decision, and that is allowed. There is no harm in that. But then, of course, somebody who knows more should be consulted, and somebody who knows fiqh, somebody who knows more details, they should be considered, not just the general knowledge, somebody who has studied them in depth. We should consult a specialist when a specialist is needed, right? And so the thing is, the basic of all of this, and we'll end with this, is that the basic of everything is taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So we, as long as we keep developing our taqwa, then our guidance, and we keep increasing our knowledge, and then it will automatically encourage us to keep following the practice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So like Allah ta'ala taught us this dua through our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-huda wa-t-tuqa. Ya Allah, I especially ask you for huda, hidayah, and I ask you for tuqa, as in taqwa. I ask you for hidayah and taqwa. May Allah Ta'ala grant all of us hidayah. May Allah Ta'ala make us those who are muttaqeen. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those people that He's pleased with, that that follow His commandments. And when we understand some commandment that Allah Ta'ala has given us, then we try our best to follow it. And whenever we are not able to do the best that we can do, then we remember to seek forgiveness from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, because we know that Allah Ta'ala's commands are there for our own best. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those people who understand that our knowledge is limited, and it is Allah Ta'ala's knowledge that is all-encompassing, and He is the one who gives us perfect family laws. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those people who do not twist or turn the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our own benefit. And may Allah ta'ala make us of those people who understand beneficial knowledge, who are not misleaded by the things that we see, the practices that we see in the society around us in the name of Islam. May Allah ta'ala help us and open the doors for us for correct beneficial knowledge and give us the ability to follow them. May Allah ta'ala make us of those people who see the truth as truth, and may He give us the ability to follow it. May Allah ta'ala make us of those people, and may He help us to see the falsehood as false, and our ability to refrain from it. Give us those ability to refrain from it. May Allah ta'ala accept us coming together today. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka antas samiul alim. Just as Allah ta'ala united us as sisters in Islam in this world, may Allah ta'ala reunite us again as sisters in Islam under the shade of His throne on the day of judgment, when there'll be no shade except His. And then may He reunite us in Jannatul Firdaus, where we can have our Jannah level parties. Subhanallah. May Allah ta'ala make us of those people that He's pleased with, who get to see His face, who follow His commands in this world, and who are the recipients of His pleasure in this world and the next. I mean, any goodness that comes from today's talk is from Allah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, because He owns all goodness, and any shortcomings are mine and mine alone, because I'm a human being and open to shortcomings. May Allah ta'ala forgive my mistakes and accept from all of us. Subhanaka Allahumma ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.